Barnsley Council's nuclear bomb-proof shelter has been closed after being destroyed by vandals.
The scaffolder was unaware that he'd shot himself in the head with a rivet gun until he went to the canteen and found he couldn't take his hard hat off.
Owing to drought and shortage of water, we have closed three lanes of the swimming pool.
Everybody talks about the news. Not all the talk is serious. Over a drink, over tea, we laugh, we muse, we gasp, giggle, gossip, and the chat is irreverent, quirky. And that's what the news quiz has essentially been about. When it started in 1977, we'd come through the 60s, so irreverence was nothing new. Ned Sherrin was already running a news-based quiz of the week on TV. A young producer working in BBC Light Entertainment, John Lloyd, was asked to come up with a radio version.
Everybody reads a paper, even if it's only The Sun, and everybody likes a good quotation, everybody likes a laugh. I've since thought the job of a producer or director, though it doesn't seem like this, is to get out of the way. You simply need to allow the people to be who they can be.
We present the news quiz, and here's the chairman, Barry Norman.
When it was launched with Barry Norman in the chair, the news quiz was very Grub Street, a forum for hacks, mostly unknown, regular team captains with a changing cast of guest players vying with one another to see who knew most about the week's news. There was even an unwritten rule that only journalists would be allowed on the panel. Danny Greenstone worked on the early programmes with John Lloyd.
We had the rule because it would be too simple to simply populate the show with comedians. There were too many good ones around, and we wanted the news quiz to be very different and to stand out from yet another radio show that was an excuse to bring comedians to the microphone. There are a lot of those. There are a lot of those still, and they're all great shows. But the news quiz was forging a style of programme that hadn't been heard for a long time.
Well, now, let me introduce this week's panel, who are Alan Coren, the editor of Punch, Richard Ingrams, editor of Private Eye, Clement Freud, MP, and the newscaster and broadcaster, Angela Rippon.
And to make it different, to make certain that you listen and that you enjoy it and we have informed people on, we're not going to go and book a selection of comics who will twist the news story to provide themselves a feed for the gag that they want to do.
And right from the beginning, there was quite a lot of flack from the department of, you know, who are these guys? If you can imagine it, people like Richard Ingrams and Alan Coren had barely broadcast. So they were not well-known names in the way that Nicholas Parsons was, or, you know, Clement Freud or Kenneth Williams or whatever. And they weren't seen to be LE-type guys. And it looked like I'd gone completely the wrong way. But it was one of those shows. I think it may, in fact, be the only show, the only pilot I've ever made that right from the beginning looked like an amazing winner.
And I'd just like to leave you with this cutting from Monday's Daily Express. It was talking about how reporters had met Bjorn Borg and his fiancée at London Airport at midday on Sunday, and it said, and I quote, "At the airport, there were the inevitable questions about marriage. Don't talk about it now. I only got out of bed an hour ago," he said. "Now I want to get home for a good night's sleep. Goodbye."
A combination of good casting and simplicity of format was obviously at the core. But there was perhaps something else. The programme started strong and confident and attracted its own momentum. Listeners tuned in expecting to laugh. Panellists turned up expecting it to be fun.
It shot off like a rocket. It was getting a million listeners within 3 weeks.
As the weeks went by and the programme was established, it became a public duel for the two team captains, the editors of both major humorous magazines of the era, Punch and Private Eye. Here's Danny Greenstone again.
It was actually like buying the entire programme in one fell swoop. With Private Eye, we got Richard Ingrams as editor. With Punch, of course, we got Alan Coren. And they established themselves very, very quickly and very firmly in the public consciousness too, as the, as it were, the bookends of the programme.
But what with Richard Ingrams on one side from Private Eye and me on the other from Punch, And I used to have a say. We all had a say in who we wanted with us. And Richard would get in. Well, his lot was too young. His lot was still on the tit. Richard had people like John Wells, Peter Cook, you know, smashing private eye people. And I would have friends of mine from Punch, who were often women people like Anne Leslie, Joan Bakewell, Catherine Whitehorn. So it sort of fell into two sorts of people. The public school languid side on the one, and ours, who were the pushy new grammar school generation trying to destroy the others. And that gave it a sort of edge.
Punch had been going since the 19th century. Private Eye had been started in the 60s and was regarded as young, fashionable, more racy and more risky. Paradoxically, the two editors showed the contrary traits to their magazines. Punch had been given to Alan Coren, dynamic, hard-working, Jewish, to zap up its rather fusty image, whereas Private Eye had been started by languid, louche, English establishment, public school types. In Alan Coren and Richard Ingram's, the News Quiz found two radio naturals who were perfect foils for one another. Ingram's as the laid-back toff from Private Eye, who claimed to be immune to popular culture and never knew any of the answers, pitted against the fiercely competitive, sharp-as-a-razor humour of the ever-so-slightly chippy Alan Coren. Richard Ingram's.
There was always a kind of Punch-Private Eye rivalry because Private Eye, in a way, had been started as an antidote to Punch in the 60s. You know, the old joke about Punch was that it was what you saw in the dentist's waiting room. However much they said, well, actually, it isn't there anymore and dentists don't have waiting rooms anymore. That was the image that it had, and it was a very difficult one for people like Alan to reverse that.
By the time we arrive at the News Quiz, the two roles had been set down, that Private Eye would be scurrilous, investigative, run the line close to liable, and ours would be young but light-hearted, so that Punch was very... I mean, Punch was a very commercially successful magazine. Private Eye wasn't. Private Eye was done on sugar paper the way it is now. Didn't have advertisements, but it ran at a profit because it had very high cover sales. We had lower cover sales, but we had that sort of niche marketing of the rich that meant we had a lot of advertising. Punch was unquestionably more suburban, nothing wrong with that. Private Eye was more Soho.
I mean, in a way, Private Eye was a sort of naughty schoolboy, and Punch was the old dad sitting in his club.
And yet, in radio terms, in broadcasting terms, when you put Richard Ingram's and Alan Coren up against each other, what you actually got was the editor of the jolly, comfortable gentleman's club magazine, Punch, being the more vicious, in a funny way, of course, of the two contributors, and Richard Ingram's, who made an absolute virtue out of claiming to not have read the newspapers that week and not know any news and being very light and fluffy.
Richard, why is Thomas Williams likely to be thirsty everywhere but Portsmouth?
Ah, I mean, I'm very glad I'm going to maintain my score of naught. Following this round.
Well, Clement Freud.
I don't know who this man Williams is.
My own attitude was, which is always has been, actually, to everything, that of an amateur who doesn't sort of try very hard.
The greater truth is that Richard Ingram's played it entirely to his advantage. I think he grabbed what he had in his head with both hands and expanded it into a character.
Richard Ingram's, your music.
You play these awful pop records. I never knew what any of them were, and I've never made any effort to know what they were.
Well, as you obviously recognise, Richard, that is the signature tune of Pot Black. So, if that music be the food of love, for whom should it play on?
Well, I was going to say it was Mrs. Thatcher playing the piano, and the news that she was going to be friends again with Edward Heath. Or Edward Heath, but it isn't that.
Mrs. Mill.
No, she doesn't play. No,
she doesn't play the piano. But she,
no, not in Pot Black.
If she did,
doesn't.
I feel that that's how she would play.
Would anybody else like to suggest?
Come along, Alan.
But I mean, that was absolutely no affectation on my part. I still don't know anything about any of these people, and I don't intend to find out.
He liked the idea of being an old man.
Harry Thompson is Ingram's biographer, and produced the News Quiz from the mid-80s.
I mean, he did seem like an old man to me at the time. This would be in the mid-80s. But if I work it out now, he was actually in his mid-40s. So he's about 5 years older than I am now. And he was just doing this pensioner act. And part of it involved...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.